we've learned on the ground seem contrary to that reassuring picture. Last week, HHS IG official Ann Maxwell told us that her office saw cases in which the Department of Homeland Security separated children based on the parents' criminal history, including, for example, a prior charge of marijuana possession. Mr. Secretary, does a parent's prior charge for marijuana possession justify taking his or her child away?
So I want to start with the rare portion of this. Fewer than 1,000 juveniles have been separated from their parents crossing the border this fiscal year. That's with 450,000 crossings of family units. This is carefully governed by policy and by court order that needs to have a criminal background or issue, as you referenced, potential communicable disease or medical emergency, or risk of abuse or neglect from the parent to the child. This is in the interest of the child. It's carefully governed, it's overseen by a supervisor, and those decisions are made. And criminal history, yes, is a factor if there's an extraditable warrant or a prosecution for another offense.
Okay, and so do you think that marijuana, a prior charge of marijuana possession justifies taking children away from the parent?
It depends on the totality of the individual case. It's kind of hard
if there were nothing else, if there were no other factors.
I'd have to look at the kind of case you referenced.
According to recently released HHS information on about 3,000 child separation cases, the large majority of them are labeled as taking place based on a parent's criminal history, which could include prosecutions, charges, or mere allegations of past crimes based on unsubstantiated information shared by foreign governments. So I want to be clear about this. Are separations taking place based on unsubstantiated evidence regarding suspected criminal backgrounds without criminal convictions?
So when we have an allegation of a serious crime that we're concerned about, especially if it's from a U.S. jurisdiction, that would be cause to consider separation of that case. We also partner with foreign governments. We work closely with law enforcement in Central America and in Mexico. And when we have referrals of criminal activity, a conviction, a indictment, or gang affiliation that's substantiated based on our partnership and our understanding of their mechanisms, their information collection procedures, we do take that into consideration in the safety of the child.
Let me take a case kind of like that. According to the Houston Chronicle, there was a 19-year-old Salvadoran woman identified as Maria who'd been abused by adult gang members for years. She was present at a gang fight, was taken into custody by the police, but was never charged with anything. But this interaction was enough for border agents to imprison her and to take away her 2-year-old son for more than 5 months. Do you think that was appropriate?
Again, I'd have to look at the specific factors in that case. I'm not sure that the Houston Chronicle has the same information that was provided by our foreign government partner. And that's again, governed carefully by policy, with discretion at the supervisory level in the field for making those decisions.
Okay, we've seen evidence to suggest that three sisters were taken away from their father in November of 2018, allegedly because he was HIV positive. Is that a proper basis upon which to remove children from their parents?
Again, you're referencing a number of specific cases that I do not have in front of me. I'm not sure if that was the only factor involved in that decision.
But let's assume it was. Just hypothetically speaking, then, would you remove for that
simple reason? Fact of being HIV positive does not sound like that would meet the standard. There could be other complications medically that would have required a temporary separation.
Do you have written civil standards that you use in order to determine whether children should be removed from their parents?
We do have a policy and operational guidance consistent with the executive order and court order that's been sent out to the field and has been implemented.
Can you make that available to us?
Of course.
Last week, Jennifer Nagda of the Young Center testified before this committee. Her group is appointed by the Department of HHS to advocate for vulnerable children, including 120 recently separated children. On average, these kids, she testified, were 7 years old, and they were in custody for 115 days before seeing their parents. According to Ms. Nagda, the center found that separation was contrary to the best interests of the child in nearly every single case. Do you commit to this committee today and to Congress to have a policy where children will only be removed from their parents if there is a compelling reason to advance the child's own health and safety?
So we also have compelling reasons for criminal prosecutions that, are also a relevant interest, as understood by the court and expressed by the executive order. But I'd be happy to work with this committee to evaluate our procedures on separation, to hear Ms. Nagda's testimony about her concerns, and to consider ongoing how we can improve what we do.
I appreciate that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Mr. Cloud.